show that f of x is equals to x squared is integrable on the closed interval 0 comma a, and the integral from 0 to a x squared dx is equals to a cubed by 3. Solution: f of x is equal to x squared is bounded on the closed interval 0 comma a, that is 0 less than or equal to f of x less than or equal to a squared for all x belong to the closed interval 0 comma a. That is, if we keep x is equal to 0 in the function f of x, we have 0 squared. That is, x squared becomes 0 squared. 0 squared is 0. And the other end value is a. Keep x is equals to a. When you keep x is equals to a, we have a squared. That is the other end value of f of x. Thus, f of x takes the value from 0 to a squared. And hence, f of x is bounded on the closed interval 0 comma a. Now consider the partition. The partition P is in general taken as x naught equals to a, that is, x naught is the very first value of the given interval. If you consider the given interval is closed interval a comma b, then a will be the very first value of the given interval. Then x1, x2, so on, xr minus 1, comma xr, so on, xn is equals to b. B the partition, and this partition consists of n plus 1 points of division. What is the first point of division? The first point of division, namely x0, is taken as the very first value of the given closed interval. That is, x naught is equals to 0. The second point of division, namely x1, is obtained by the formula a plus b minus a by n, where a is the very first value of the given interval and b is the last value of the given closed interval. Here small a is 0 and small b is a. Place of a we keep 0, in the place of b we keep a, and hence this is equals to a is 0 plus b is a minus a is 0 divided by n. That is equals to 0 plus a minus 0 by n is equal to 0 plus a by n. That is equals to a by n. Therefore, the second point of division x1 is a by n. What is the third point of division? Third point of division is x2. That can be obtained by the formula a plus 2 times b minus a by n, and hence this becomes 2a by n. Then the fourth point of division is x3, whose value will be 3a by n. R plus 1th point of division is xr. What is the value of xr? Xr is obtained by the formula a plus r into b minus a by n. A equal to 0, b equals to a, therefore it becomes r into a by n, that is r a by n. That is, the r plus 1th point of division xr is r a by n. Then what is the last point of division? The last point of division is xn. And what is xn? Xn supposed to be the end value of the given closed interval. Here it is a. Let us get the n plus 1th point of division. N plus 1th point of division is xn, which can be obtained by the formula a plus n into b minus a by n. Here A is 0, B is A, therefore it is n into A by n, that is n get cancelled, that is equals to A, and this A is the end value of the given interval. Thus we know that the very first point of division is the starting value of the given interval, and the last point of division must be the end point of the given closed interval. Thus here we have the first point of division is 0 and the last point of division is A, and hence whatever we obtain the values of the points of division are correct. Thus the partition becomes x0 is 0, x1 is a by n, x2 is 2a by n, x3 is 3a by n, xr is ra by n, and xn is na by n is equals to a. The partition P consists of n plus 1 points of divisions, namely 0, comma a by n, comma 2a by n, comma 3a by n, so on, r minus 1a by n, and the r plus 1th point of division ra by n, and the n plus 1th point of division xn is equals to a. Now this is the partition we are going to consider in this problem. IR, we know that IR is the rth sub-interval of the given partition, because this partition consists of n sub-intervals and n plus 1 points of division. The first sub-interval, namely I1, is 0 to a by n. The second sub-interval I2 is from the closed interval a by n to 2a by n, so on. Therefore, the rth sub-interval IR is the closed interval xr minus 1 comma xr. Xr minus 1 is r minus 1 into a by n. Xr is ra by n. Therefore, IR is the closed interval r minus 1 into a by n comma ra by n. What is the length of each sub-interval? Since we are divided the given closed interval 0 to a into n equal parts, the length of each sub-interval will be the second point of division minus first point of division, that is a by n minus 0 is a by n, or the general formula is b minus a by n, where b is the end value of the given closed interval and a is the beginning value of the given closed interval. Therefore, it is b minus a by n is equals to a minus 0 by n equal to a by n. So this b minus a by n is the general formula. But problems, we can use the simple idea, namely second point of division minus first point of division. Therefore, length of each sub-interval is a by n. Since the function f of x is equal to x squared is an increasing function on the closed interval 0 to a, capital MR, the supremum of f in the rth sub-interval is f of xr. F of xr is equals to f of, what is xr? Xr value is ra by n. Therefore, f of xr is equals to f of ra by n. What is f of ra by n? We are given the function f of x is equal to x squared. Therefore, f of ra by n is equals to ra by n whole squared. That is r squared into a squared by n squared. It is true for every value of r from 1 to n. Similarly, small mr is the infimum of the function f in the rth sub interval that can be obtained by f of xr minus 1. Because the function is an increasing function, supremum will be f of r, infimum will be f of xr minus 1. That is, f of xr minus 1 is equals to f of r minus 1 a by n. What is the value of f of r minus a by n? Just replace x by r minus 1 into a by n in the given function, namely f of x is equal to x squared. Therefore, f of r minus 1 into a by n is equals to r minus 1 into a by n whole squared. That is equals to r minus 1 squared into a squared by n squared. Now look at the difference. The difference between capital MR and small MR is, in capital MR it is r squared, in small MR it is r minus 1 whole squared. The same thing will be true in the case of upper Riemann sum and lower Riemann sum. We shall now calculate upper Riemann sum or upper Darboux sum u of p comma f. That is equals to sigma r equal to 1 to n capital MR into delta r. Capital MR is the supremum of the function f in the rth sub interval, and delta r is the length of the rth sub interval. Here r is running from 1 to n. That is equals to sigma r equal to 1 to n, capital MR value is r squared into a squared by n squared, delta r value is a by n. Let us multiply these two factors, hence we get sigma r equal to 1 to n, r squared into a squared into a is a cubed, n squared into n is n cubed. We can write this as a cubed by n cubed into sigma r equal to 1 to n r squared, because here the only variable is r, and hence a and n are constant. Therefore we have taken the factor a cubed by n cubed out. We are going to apply sum to r squared. We all know that sigma r equal to 1 to n r squared is equals to 1 squared plus 2 squared plus 3 squared, so on, plus n squared. This is the sum of squares of first n natural numbers, that is equals to n into n plus 1 into 2n plus 1 by 6. Therefore, the step becomes a cubed by n cubed into sigma r equal to 1 to n r squared becomes n into n plus 1 into 2n plus 1 by 6. We will calculate the value of upper Riemann integral. We know that the upper Riemann integral, namely integral from a to b bar f of x dx, where b bar stands for upper Riemann, that is equals to limit norm p tends to 0, or you can write n tends to infinity, u of p comma f, that is equals to limit n tends to infinity u of p comma f. Just now we have found the value of u of p comma f. Now we are going to apply limit as n tends to infinity. We know that a value is 0 and b value is a, and f of x value is x squared. Therefore this integral becomes integral 0 to a bar x squared into dx, that is equals to limit n tends to infinity, the value of UPF is equals to a cubed by n cubed into n plus 1 into 2n plus 1 by 6. Now, we have to apply limit n tends to infinity. That is equals to a cubed by 6 into limit n tends to infinity n squared into n plus 1 into 2n plus 1 by n cubed. Here a cubed and 6 both are constant, therefore we are taken out. Now we are going to apply limit to this factor. Since limit n tends to infinity, our aim is to eliminate the maximum powers of n, and we'll try to get 1 by n or 1 by n to the power some value as factors, so that when you take limit n tends to infinity, limit n tends to infinity of 1 by n tends to 0. In the numerator, we have 1n here. We can take 1n from the factor n plus 1. Also, we can take 1n out from the factor 2n plus 1. And hence, we'll be getting a cubed by 6 limit n tends to infinity. N into n is n cubed. When we take n out from n plus 1, we get the factor 1 plus 1 by n. Here we are taken n out, therefore we get 2 plus 1 by n divided by n cubed. Now this n cubed get cancelled, and we are going to apply limit. Therefore, this equals to a cubed by 6 limit n tends to infinity 1 plus 1 by n into 2 plus 1 by n. Therefore, integral 0 to a bar x squared dx is equals to a cubed by 6. When you apply limit as n tends to infinity, 1 by n tends to 0. Therefore, 1 plus 0. Here, 2 plus, when you apply the limit, 1 by n tends to 0. Therefore, 2 plus 0, that is equals to a cubed by 6 into 2, that is equals to a cubed by 3. Let us call it as equation number 1. We shall now find the value of lower dot box sum. That is L of P comma F is equals to sigma r equals to 1 to n small mr into delta r. Small mr is the infimum of the function f in the rth subinterval. Delta r is the length of the rth subinterval. That is equals to sigma r equal to 1 to n. The infimum of the function f in the rth subinterval small m suffix r is equals to r minus 1 whole squared into a squared by n squared. Delta r value is a by n. Now we are going to multiply these two factors. When you multiply, we get sigma r equal to 1 to n r minus 1 whole squared. Here a squared into a becomes a cubed. N squared into n becomes n cubed. In this summation, the variable is r. Therefore, a cubed by n cubed is a common factor. Therefore, take it out. That is equals to a cubed by n cubed into sigma r equal to 1 to n r minus 1 whole squared. What is the value of sigma r equals to 1 to n r minus 1 whole squared? Let us keep r is equals to 1. When you put r equals to 1, r minus 1 whole squared becomes 1 minus 1 whole squared, that is 0 squared. Now let us put r equals to 2. When you put r equals to 2, r minus 1 whole squared becomes 2 minus 1 whole squared, that is 1 squared. Now let us keep r is equals to 3. When you keep r equals to 3, r minus 1 whole squared becomes 3 minus 1 whole squared is 2 squared, so on. The last value of r is n. Now let us keep r equal to n, then it becomes r minus 1 whole squared becomes n minus 1 whole squared. And this is the sum of the squares of first n minus 1 natural numbers. We know the formula to find the sum of squares of first n natural numbers. The formula is n into n plus 1 into 2n plus 1 by 6. Whereas here the n value is n minus 1. Therefore, it is equals to n minus 1 into n into 2n minus 1 by 6. Therefore, the above expression is equals to a cubed by n cubed into n minus 1 into n into 2n minus 1 by 6. Now, we are going to find the value of lower Riemann integral, that is integral from a bar to b, where a bar stands for lower Riemann, f of x dx, that is equals to limit norm p tends to 0 L of p comma f, that is equals to limit n tends to infinity L of p comma f. The above integral becomes integral 0 bar to a x squared dx, because the a value is 0, the value of b is a, the value of f of x is x squared, which is equals to limit n tends to infinity L of p comma f. The value of L of p comma f is a cubed by n cubed into n minus 1 into n into 2n minus 1 by 6. Now we are going to apply limit n tends to infinity. Therefore, this a cubed and 6 both are constants. Let us take them out. Therefore, this equals to a cubed by 6 limit n tends to infinity n minus 1 n into 2n minus 1 by n cubed. Since we are going to apply limit as n tends to infinity, let us try to get the factors 1 by n. For that sake, we take n out from the first factor n minus 1. Also, we take one more n out from the third factor, namely 2n minus 1. The above expression is equals to a cubed by 6 into limit n tends to infinity. Here taken 1n out. There is 1n in the middle and one more n we are taken out from the third factor, and hence n into n is n cubed into 1 minus 1 by n, 2 minus 1 by n divide by n cubed. This n cubed and the n cubed in the denominator get cancelled. That is equals to a cubed by 6 into limit of 1 minus 1 by n into 2 minus 1 by n. We are going to apply limit now. Therefore, the integral 0 bar to a x squared dx is equals to a cubed by 6. When you apply limit as n tends to infinity, 1 by n tends to 0. That is equals to a cubed by 6 into 1 minus 0 into 2 minus 0. That is equal to a cubed by 6 into 2. That is equals to a cubed by 3. Let us call it as 2. From equations 1 and 2, that is integral from 0 to a bar x squared dx is equal to a cubed by 3, that is the upper Riemann integral, and the lower Riemann integral, namely integral 0 bar to a x squared dx is equal to a cubed by 3. The values of upper Riemann integral and the lower Riemann integral are equal. That is integral from 0 to a bar x squared dx is equals to integral from 0 bar to a x squared dx, and each is equals to a cubed by 3. Therefore, we say that the given function f of x is equal to x squared is integrable on the closed interval 0, a, and the value of the integral 0 to a x squared dx is equals to a cubed by 3. That is, we say that f is Riemann integrable. That is, f belongs to R of the closed interval 0, a. That is, f is Riemann integrable over closed interval 0 to a. For example, if you want to evaluate integral from 0 to 1 x squared dx, simply replace the value of a by 1 to get the answer. Therefore, integral from 0 to a, integral from 0 to 1 x squared dx becomes 1 cubed by 3, that is 1 by 3. So, simply what you have to do is replace a by 1 in the above process to get the value of integral from 0 to 1 x squared dx is equals to 1 by 3. Suppose you want to evaluate integral from 0 to 10 x squared dx, then its value will be 10 cubed by 3. 10 cubed is 1000 divided by 3. This is how we find the value of the given integral using upper Riemann integral and lower Riemann integral. 6 steps to evaluate integral of a function. This is going to explain the procedure to evaluate integral of a function using upper Riemann integral and lower Riemann integral. The first step is to divide the given interval into n equal parts and write its partition P. The second step is to write down the value of IR. IR is the rth sub interval. The third step is to find the length of each subinterval. The fourth step is to find the value of capital MR and small MR, where capital MR and small MR are the supremum and the infimum of the function f in the rth subinterval respectively. Therefore, the value of capital MR can be obtained by the formula f of xr, and small mr can be obtained using the formula f of xr minus 1. The fifth step is to find the value of upper Riemann sum and lower Riemann sum. The upper Darboux sum is given by the formula sigma r equal to 1 to n capital MR delta r, and the lower Darboux sum is defined by the formula sigma r equal to 1 to n small MR into delta r. The sixth step and the last step is to evaluate upper Riemann integral and lower Riemann integral. The upper Riemann integral can be obtained by the formula integral a to b bar f of x dx is equals to limit n tends to infinity u of p comma f, and the lower Riemann integral, namely integral a bar to b f of x dx, that is equals to limit n tends to infinity l of p comma f. These are the 6 steps involved in the problem of evaluation of integral of a function.